spent most of my adult life in Spain, and came back to Tucson about 10 years ago, working at Mission Garden, developing Mission Garden, and collaborating with Presidio too. So it's really exciting to start collaborating more with Presidio. And so the Soledad's Garden is just starting to come together. You know, a garden is a labor of love and time and patience. And it's Soledad Jacobé lived here for almost 50 years. 1866 to 1911. So she was a single mother. She had four daughters, and she was a seamstress, and she rented out rooms. So the patio garden would have been a place, an extension of the home, and people would wash there. There was a well where they drew water. We don't have a well in our contemporary garden here, but we do have a olla or a tinajera, which is where they would store water, and through evapotranspiration, they would stay cool. They would drink it out of a gourd, a dipper gourd. They would wash there, they would hang their clothes, and probably with the wash water, they would water the plants because they wouldn't waste any water. And so a lot of the plants, Soledad Jacobé was Mexican. We don't know exactly where she was from. From Sonora. But we don't know where. Sonora's a big place, and a lot of it is tropical. A lot of the home gardens of this culture often have containers. A lot of the plants are culinary, medicinal plants, and also flowers, ornamentals. And these gardens, when I was in Spain, I started gardening with my neighbors. You don't usually go to a nursery and buy plants. When you go to live somewhere, your neighbors welcome you by giving you a plant or sharing a cutting or seeds. So a garden is something that grows over time. And so now it's just getting started. And so I think also there would be fruit trees. Fruit trees provide a lot of shade, so you can be outside. Also food, and so you have fruit trees, you have culinary medicinal herbs, you have flowers, probably flowers for a lot of women and ladies that I know, that's their favorite part of the garden because it's just joy. And any other? Oh, yes, the star of this garden, I'm in awe of this black mission fig that's in the corner. It's a heirloom, it's been here
since the 1880s.
At least since the 1880s. So fig trees can live very long, at least for 100 years, and longer. And it's still fruiting. We just had the brevas, the first crop of the figs. A couple of weeks ago, they were delicious. So it's very productive. Not sure how, because the soil has not been amended. It's just very hard, and there's a little bit of the city irrigation there, but amazing. This tree is still alive, so it's a really special tree. Right. So Homer is saying there's an outhouse in that place, part of the garden. Of course, they had their outhouse in the garden. Also, the well that was pretty close to the outhouse. And so they think that perhaps that's why the fig tree is doing so well. Right. So he thinks the outhouse is providing the perfect, okay, so you're explaining why, the perfect conditions for the fig tree to survival in this time. It's a really special tree, so it's a gem. We're going to have to propagate it so we can make sure that it continues. sure. I've seen things on the university. I'm not sure. I'm not sure. We'll have to go and find the fruits and try the fruits. That's the best way.
It's got a lot of green ones, right?
So it's probably a different variety.
Yeah.
Are they small? And we'll go back in like mid-July or and see what kind they are.
I have a question. Were there any diaries or anything that, or did you just? How did you come up with what you planned? This is really interesting.
Well, some of what we know is we took samples of the dirt and threw them in water, and the charred plant materials rose to the surface. And our ethnobotanist that we have in desert archaeology identify what plants there were. And I gave Dina a list, which now I don't really remember much, but there were raspberry seeds, I think. But those are probably.
And the things that they actually determined were here were figs, chilies, tomatoes, raspberries, corn and wheat. So we're for some of the other natives, but I think that's about it. Prickly bear fruit, the seeds of.
Either she was going out into the desert to get saguaro fruits, or she might have been getting them from the Tona Adam, who would come in and trade that sort of thing.
Right, so not necessarily the things that were eaten were grown there. So I kind of just based what I planted on my kind of an educated guess of what might be there in terms of the cultural.
Talk about the jujube.
The jujube is there because, Fei Tom, who's a prominent Chinese person here from Tucson, goes way back in one of the oldest Chinese families. He donated the jujube to Presidio because it would be appropriate. Soledad rented out a room to at least one Chinese tenant, and a lot of the Chinese here did grow jujubes, and so that's why there's the jujube. There was a lot of Chinese living right around here, and there was a lot of fusion between the Hispanic and the Chinese cultures, and a lot of sharing.
Anything else?
Soledad is buried in the Holy Home Cemetery, and one of our volunteers, Mary Graff, interprets Soledad, and Mary Graff has the idea of somebody raising money in her tombstone. She doesn't have a tombstone.
Oh, wow.
And we know that there are descendants of Soledad in the community, and we would like to eventually find them and see if they have any stories about her. She died in 1911, so it's possible that they don't remember her very much, but that would be something we'd like to find out.
I have a question. It's just good. So the relationship between Soledad Jacome and Jacomes? Nothing. Okay. Not even family? It's a similar name.
She was here first. She got here by 1858.
Right, but it wasn't a good relation. Okay.
So she was a widow?
Well, it's not known whether her because of the Homer's work on looking at the census, he wasn't here. He disappeared at one point.
There's a guy, a similar age, the same name, but he's not living in Tucson. He's living somewhere else. It looks like they were never married because the children are illegitimate from the church records. So I think her husband left her for another woman and went off with his naughty.
He could have died. He could have disappeared. His name was Juan Cienos. And he was, in 1873, he was not around by then. So she lived a long time alone, raising her four daughters. Yeah.
question?
Kind of not related. You talked about the squirrels. How do you eat a squirrel? Is it the red or the seeds or what is it?
So right now, actually last night, we were my boyfriend. We were in the desert harvesting saguaro. And you can't just go out in the desert. You have to, it has to be a property that belongs to you. In this case, we were with some Oaxacan people who have a camp. And what you do is you poke with a long stick, you poke it, it falls down, you try to catch it in a bucket. Inside is the fruit. Inside. And that's what you can eat it juicy and drippy and fresh, or when it dries a little bit more and it's like candy, it hardens a little bit. You can eat it just like that, right off the saguaro, or you can make syrup, or you can make jam. You can red, yeah. When it's open, you can see that's what you pick.
This is Carrie Neathammer who's speaking. She's written some cookbooks about desert foods.
Inside is red fruit with tiny little black seeds. So if you're trying to visualize it, you know, visualize a watermelon. And that the gathering of them was the start of the Tohono O'odham year. That was, they would go out into the desert and gather. And then also, it prayed for rain, and you can imagine why. There was no AC, no swamp coolers, no nothing. It was, you know, it was hot, probably not as hot as it is now, but very hot. And we all want rain, and so there was at the beginning, their New Year's celebration, the rain ceremony. So it was a very special time for the Tohono O'odham.
Carrie, introduce yourself.
My name is Carolyn Niehammer. I write about edible wild plants. Oh, and I have a new book coming out. I should not waste this opportunity.
Go ahead, promote it.
On September 22nd, I have a new book coming out called Desert Feast, Celebrating Tucson's Culinary History. And it's the answer to why Tucson was named the UNESCO City of Gastronomy. And Dina's pictures in there, and there's a long interview with Homer, and a big story about this, and hey, who's Seuss is in there? Oh, my friends.
Also, some Chinese history.
Oh, yeah. They're all
Chinese. Anything else?
Give a quick promo for Mission Garden.
Garden, as I mentioned before. Has anybody been to Mission Garden? A lot of collaborators. Almost everybody here knows. For those of you who don't, you should visit. So it's a kind of sister organization to the Presidio, and it's at the foot of a mountain, which is Chukchong. So it's the base of the Black Mountain. That's how Tucson got its name. And there was a Mission Garden there during period, but there were people living there, often people living there when the missionaries arrived, and already growing crops. And so Mission Garden kind of represents all the agricultural history of the Tucson Basin, which is over 4,000 years old, which can be remarkable for sure. But so it's kind of representing all of the agricultural history of the Tucson Basin. It's open. We've been open all throughout the COVID since it's outdoors, and we're practicing distancing and wearing masks as we garden.
In the heat.
But it's open Wednesday through Saturday from 8 to 12. So it's just a lot of layers of history, and we're representing all those layers of history through them.
Excellent. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to sign off now and come back on for our desert lecture shortly.